wants to start. All right. So good afternoon, everybody. My name is Jesse, and I'm with Exploring by the Seat of Your Pants. We are all about bringing conservation, adventure, and science to classrooms around the world. We're really excited to this April because we are spending the entire month dedicated to climate research, as many hangouts on that theme as possible, all sponsored by Environment and Climate Change Canada. So a huge shout out to them. Right now, we've got all eight of our classes in from across North America, so I'm going to give them a chance to do a bit of a shout-out and show how excited they are for water security and our presenter today. So we've got Miss Newell's class, grade 8 in Guelph, Ontario. Hi, guys.
Woo!
Hey, they didn't get their video working, but their enthusiasm is there, Mike Wise. We've got Miss Nagy's grade 6s in Milton, Ontario. Hi, guys. The ball high with epic enthusiasm. We've got Miss Diesel's grade 6-7s in Bradford, Ontario. Got one kid who's like super high pitched there. We've got Miss Presner's grade 5 in Parkridge, Illinois, representing the entire United States. Hi, guys. Right. We've got Miss Tabella's grade 4s in Manitoba, Ontario as well. 3 Ontario Day. Hi, guys.
Hi.
We've got Ms. Vert's grade 4 through 8s in Prince Albert, Ontario. You promised you'd get the class in and you did. I appreciate it. Awesome. And then their mics were a little iffy. We'll see if we got them. We got Ms. Hugg's grade 6s in Guelph, Ontario. Hi, guys. I like the red lighting. I really need to find out what's going on with that later. And then we've got Ms. Grade 5s in Toronto, Ontario, if they got their mic working. Did they? Hey. Hi, guys, if you are. Yes, we did. Okay. Everybody's mic's working. Of course, the reason you guys are all here today is for our speaker. So we are joined live from Cambridge in the UK by Francesca Hanlon. She is a PhD candidate at the University of Cambridge there. And her research looks at climate change and resilience to climate-related disasters in developing countries around the world. Her work has taken her from El Salvador to Mexico, Central African Republic to South Sudan and more. And as a result of all her efforts, she founded Blue Tap, which is a social enterprise that uses 3D printing to provide household water purification in developing countries. So amazing work. And without further ado, thank you so much for joining us, Francesca, and take it away.
Hi, everyone. Thank you very much for having me here. I'm really, really excited to share to you all my knowledge that I've gained over the years about climate change, about water, and about how it's really impacting people in the poorest countries in the world. So I'm British. I'm from London, but I'm studying at the University of Cambridge. I hope you understand my accent. Some of my words might be like a little bit different, but in general, I think they're pretty similar, like Canadian, American, and English. So I'll get started with the presentation, yeah?
Sounds good.
All right. Let's see. What do we got? Looking good?
You're perfect. Full screen. It's all good.
Okay. What I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you about who I am and why I made all the decisions to become an engineer. So when I was a kid, when I was like 8, 9, 10, I really liked science and math. And I really liked fixing things, but I also really liked people. I was really social and outgoing. And when I got to choose what I was going to do at university, I knew I wanted to help people. And that was a really important thing to me. So I thought maybe, you know, who helps people? It's doctors. I didn't really like biology so much. I more preferred physics and maths. And no one had really told me when I was younger about this thing called engineering. And then I discovered it and I realized it was exactly the thing that I could do to help people. So I went to university and I studied civil and environmental engineering because I was really interested in the environment as well. I was really like an outdoorsy person that likes hiking and surfing. And then straight after university, I worked for loads of different charities who use engineering to help some of the poorest people in the world. So one of them was Engineers Without Borders, which is really cool. I think it was actually founded in Canada originally, but there's a UK version. And I worked with them in Mexico, and that was really good. And then afterwards, I worked with this massive charity, one of the biggest ones in the world, and they're called Doctors Without Borders. And what they do is they provide healthcare to people who, are having a bit of a difficult time, people in settings where there's not much money or if there's conflict. And that was a really great experience for me. And I'll talk to you a little bit about that experience. As a result of it, I realized that, you know, from firsthand, I was talking to people in Africa who were saying, climate change is having such a big impact on our lives. And I thought I really wanted to do something to help. So I decided to do some research and through a PhD to understand what the problems were and how we could help people who are really feeling the effects of climate change right now today. So then I came to Cambridge to do my PhD and I'm nearly finished with that. So what I'm gonna do is talk to you a bit about that whole journey and some of the things that I found out. So first of all, why engineering? Now, hopefully listening right now, there are some young girls in the class thinking, I wanna be an engineer. Because I don't know if you know, but it's typically pretty male dominated. That means there's just more men and more boys studying engineering than there are girls. And girls are pretty good at engineering. When I was at university, there were 125 students and I think only 20 were women. So I really want other young girls to be interested in engineering. It's a super good topic because you get to go out into the environment or out into the field and you get to actually use your brain and your skills to help people. So that was really my motivation. And it was really fun. I liked maths and I liked science. And you know, I was in school every day and I was learning all this maths and I kept putting my hand up and saying, okay, so I've worked out how to do this equation, but what's the point? What can I use it for? And all of my maths teachers said, ah, you sound like an engineer. So that's what I went to do. So engineers really, really good to contribute to this thing called sustainable development. And I spent quite a long time studying sustainable development. And the way that I summarize it is it's like we want the whole world to grow equally. We want people to have a similar amount of wealth, but we don't want people just to have wealth without having, you know, human rights as well. We want everyone, regardless of religion or race or sexual orientation, to have human rights. But while we develop in that way, we also want to protect our planet, because if we don't think about the planet, then it's not going to be there for our children and the next generation and the people in the year 2100. So that's kind of how sustainable development is summarized. And it's become a really important topic. And what the United Nations has done, which is this like massive organization that covers lots of countries, that kind of sets the rules about how we want to develop. So they've founded the Sustainable Development Goals. When I was about 21, I had my engineering skills. I knew I wanted to contribute to society. And I thought, okay, I can't focus on all 17 of these goals because I'm gonna be super busy if I do. What's the one that I really care about? And I looked at goal 6, clean water and sanitation. And I thought, that's really important. And actually, I know this sounds a bit silly, but a big part of it was I'm really into surfing. And I thought, you know, water's so important to me for my enjoyment, for my health. And I wanted everyone to appreciate it and to be able to appreciate it in the way that I did. So I put a real big focus on making sure that, you know, my work was towards getting people clean water and sanitation. I did some research and I thought, what are the problems that come up? And what I discovered was it's just such a huge problem. So there's 2.4 billion people who don't have access to just a normal toilet. There's about the same number of people in the world who can't go, you know, in their house, in their kitchen, they can't just turn on their tap and drink their water because if they drank it, it would probably be dirty and then it would make them sick. And that's so big because I think, you know, there's something like above 7 billion people in the world. So such a huge number of people who have this problem. And us here in the UK and in Canada and in the US, like we don't have this issue. So it's really hard to understand sometimes. And I was always thinking, you know, isn't it crazy that we can put scientists into space and we've got artificial intelligence and all this really high tech technology, but we can't, you know, provide the world with just clean water and good sanitation. And I really thought this is what I want to dedicate my life towards, you know, working to. So I looked around and I thought, what organizations are working towards this goal? And I found one called MSF, if you're French. So Médecins Sans Frontières, so a little bit of a French lesson we'll squeeze in there. But in the US and the UK, it's called Doctors Without Borders. And they are incredible. What they do is they set up hospitals for anyone who's in a country that has had trouble. So if it's a country where, for example, there's a natural disaster or a conflict, or it's just very, very poor, Doctors Without Borders will go in and provide free healthcare for people. And this is really cool. But you remember I said I'm an engineer and I'm not a doctor. So I called up Doctors Without Borders and I said, look, I'm not a doctor, I'm an engineer, but I really want to help. And what they said to me, they said, you know, the most people that work for this charity, they're not doctors. If you have a team of 20 people, normally just one of them is a doctor, because to be able to get a doctor to see his patients, there's all these other things that are needed around it. You know, you need the nurses there, and then you need some engineers to be able to provide the hospital with water, or you need some engineers to be able to fix the cars to drive the doctors to the patients. So I suddenly understood that it was actually quite a big, complex challenge to get doctors to treat patients in these kind of countries that are struggling a bit. So some of the countries where MSF work, I mean, it's huge. This charity is working all over the world. And you can see in this picture here, you see all of the countries where they're working. And a lot of them is in Africa. So Africa is a really big continent. It's massive. And it's a continent where there's a lot of poverty still. So lots of people are still living on very, very little amounts of money. And often, you know, things like the train and the water, stuff that we just think we take for granted. We see it's part of, you know, our everyday life. They don't have that in a lot of the countries. So Doctors Without Borders works a lot there. And I went to work for them in a country called South Sudan, which, you know, even most adults, to be honest, have never heard of. It's so, so remote and so unknown. And then I went to work for them in a country called Central Africa Republic, which is even more remote and even more unknown. So it was these really great opportunities to see countries that, you know, you wouldn't normally get to see. So where Médecins Sans Frontières, Doctors Without Borders, does their work is they deal with health outbreaks. So for example, say there's a massive outbreak, there was a disease called Ebola in 2014 that occurred in West Africa. The doctors there at Doctors Without Borders, they went to treat the patients because you know, they needed a lot of help. It happened very quickly. Sometimes where there's war, Doctors Without Borders will go and treat some patients and treat people, especially with lots of, in Africa, there's a big population of children under 5. So lots of women giving birth, and MSF helps them to give birth in a safe way. And then you see more and more recently, natural disasters. So we've seen in the last few years, loads of typhoons, loads of hurricanes, loads of cyclones. And on that point, you know, I actually had to look the other day, what is the difference between a typhoon, a hurricane, and a cyclone? And it turns out they're all exactly the same thing. It's just they've got a different name depending on where in the world they exist. So it's called a hurricane, which is, you know, a big storm with lots of rain and wind. If it's in sort of America and the Caribbean, it's called a cyclone if it's in the sort of Africa area. And it's called a typhoon if it's in Asia. But it's all the same thing. It's a big storm that comes in, lots of rain, lots of really strong wind, and it you know, can really damage the infrastructure and the buildings and cause some flooding. So these are the kind of situations that MSF work in. So I went to work in South Sudan. And South Sudan, I think, depending on what scale you look at it, is actually the world's poorest country. So it means the people living in South Sudan have the least money out of any country in the world. And it's also the world's youngest country. So that doesn't mean that everyone's like under the age of 5, even though a lot of people are. It means that it's the newest country to be formed. So it was originally part of Sudan, which if you look at the map, that was the country above it. But in 2011, they had an independence vote and the country wanted to be independent. So they got their independence in 2011 and there was a lot of hope that the country would be able to prosper. But then there was a new war that started because there was some conflict between, you know, people that didn't agree. So what this meant was that you had a lot of populations that really needed healthcare and they couldn't get it. And so Doctors Without Borders was working there. So in 2015, I had my, you know, suitcase in my bag and I went for a year to work in South Sudan. And I had no idea what to expect. And my job was to provide the hospitals and the people in the communities where we were working with good, clean drinking water. So this picture here that you see, this is actually a water point and this is the local community. And what's different about some poor countries in Africa and places like Canada and the US is, you know, we all have water in our homes. We all have a tap that goes to our house and We don't even think about it when we run a bath or have a shower, flush the toilet, drink the water. But in South Sudan, no one really has that. So they have to all share the water. And here, this is what's called a public water point. So people come with their cans and they pick up water. And one of my jobs was to build the water point. So what's really interesting is for us, it's the government or, you know, a private organization that provides us with water. And because our countries have so much money, we can do this in a really high-tech way. And we're really certain that the water's clean and that it can get to wherever we need it. And then it comes out at, you know, at fast speed. But in South Sudan, that's not the case. And actually in this village that I was working, they didn't have any water provided. So we had to drill a big hole under the ground, get to the groundwater. So that's where the water's underneath the ground. It was about 80 meters deep. And that's really good clean water that's down there. And then you can put in a pump and you pump it up and you can get water for the rural community. So that's a little bit of engineering there. That's quite interesting because you have to know where the water is underground, know how to drill a hole to try and get it, and then know how to pump it up. So it's really pretty fun. So that was mainly what my job was there. So I talked about engineering, and what I liked so much about working in Africa compared to working in the UK is the engineering is a little bit different. And I coined this term called maverick engineering, because in the UK and the US and Canada, there's lots of rules and laws and lots of people who have done the engineering jobs before. So you follow guidelines. And this is really important because it means that buildings or infrastructure is made to a really good quality. But when you work in, say, an emergency situation where things have to be really quick, you often don't have the resources or the guidelines there. So you have to really use your instincts as an engineer and your knowledge. And this is really, really fun because you get to find solutions. So if you look at these pictures here, can you see the baby there in the bucket? So we didn't have scales in South Sudan because there's not many things there. So the way that we would weigh the babies is we put them in the bucket, and then on the other side, we'd put something that we knew the weight of, and then we'd work out how much the baby would weigh. So that was a really fun engineering challenge. And I loved it because you had to be really imaginative with how you solved problems. And then you see on the right here, so that tent there, that's actually a hospital inside that. So that's where you treat patients. But obviously, you know, there's so little resources. You have to build things really, really quickly with not much money. So it's really quite fun and exciting. And that's the type of engineering you do in international development. So after about a year of this experience, living and working in South Sudan, I was talking to people all the time. I was trying to find out what their lives were like, because it's so different from what ours is like in the Western world. And most people there only eat one food. I mean, it's amazing because if you think about all the foods you eat in a day, I ate cheese, chocolate, meat, all these things today. There, they only have one crop called sorghum, which is actually not very nice. I couldn't eat it every day, but they don't have any opportunity to get all these different foods that we have. And this crop is really, really reliant on the weather. So it needs rain at a certain time of year, and it needs, some dry period at a certain time of year to grow. And I started to speak to people about their lives. And what I kept hearing was people saying again and again, you know, the weather's really changed in the last 5 or 10 years. And I thought this was so interesting because me, I'd been to school and to university, and I'd heard all of these stories about climate change and lots of people saying, does it exist? Doesn't exist? We don't know. And the people in this region, they'd never heard of the term climate change. You know, lots of these people didn't get to go to school at all because they lived in a refugee camp. But people were describing to me exactly the effects of climate change. And I thought it was so interesting. It was such a good bit of information because you knew they weren't biased. They weren't saying it for any political reason because they didn't know about the politics. So what they were saying is, you know, for hundreds and hundreds of years, the rainy season in Africa, which is when the rain falls quite regularly every day, was between April and October. And this was really good because in April to October, all the crops would grow and people could farm them, so they'd have food to eat. and you know, they'd be healthy. They could eat food, they could sell the food. It was a really good thing. And then they had the dry season, which was October to April, you know, over our northern hemisphere winter. And that worked. And then the people who were 25, 26, they were saying to me, you know, these last 5-6 years, the weather's completely changed and we don't understand why. And what's happening now is the rain's only falling in August and it's falling really, really hard. And we have so much rain that it completely floods. And then it's not there for the rest of the time. So the crops aren't used to this and the crops die or they just don't grow. And it's really affecting people. And actually that's been so bad that the United Nations, that big organization that sets the sustainable development goals, they said, actually, there's a famine now in South Sudan because of this. So it's a really big problem. This picture here, actually, that you see on the screen with these women, they're carrying sticks to build their homes. This was this is actually the airstrip that the planes for Doctors Without Borders would take us to projects. So if you imagine your airstrip in your airport, if you've been on a plane, you know, it's nice, big concrete, really smooth. Landing on this airstrip was much scarier, I have to say, sometimes. So this photo, this is what it's like when it flooded. So the planes couldn't land, but also it's quite bad because, you know, flooding's not only bad because it destroys things, it's also really dangerous because you've got quite a lot of dirty water there. So I discovered this problem and I spoke to people and I just thought, this is huge and I really want to do something to contribute to try and make it better. And I looked into it and I saw that people were saying that the predominant means main, basically, the main impacts of climate change on humans and the environment occur through water. So it's almost like, in my eyes, you can't talk about the impacts of climate change without really talking about how we interact with water and how people in developing countries also interact with water. So some of these things that happen is, for example, you get lots of refugees. So a refugee is someone who has to leave their country and they have to leave their country because either there's a war, there's sort of politics, or what we're seeing more and more is people leaving their country because of these really extreme weather events from climate change. And these extreme weather events are these big storms that I mentioned, you know, hurricanes, typhoons, cyclones, which are all the same thing. And you see that in recent years, you know, the 10 biggest reasons that people have had to leave their homes is actually because of these climate change events. So in India, there were some floods. In Indonesia, there were some floods. In China, typhoons again. So it's a really big problem. And what's really interesting about it, right, is it's actually the people who live in the poorer countries that are more likely to be affected by a disaster or by climate change. And the reasons for that are quite a few. So one of them is these extreme weather events, you're seeing them in locations in the world that are closer to the equator. So that's like really, you know, the center line of the world. And in these places, it's just, you know, slightly hotter climates. And so you're more likely to have these extreme strong events. Like in England, we have a really normal temperate climate. So we don't see cyclones, hurricanes or typhoons. But also it's because in developing countries, the buildings and the roads and the infrastructure is less good at protecting the populations. So if you look at, you know, you had a big hurricane, you remember Hurricane Sandy in the United States? Well, not many people died. But then you had a similar event in Myanmar, which is a country just next to India, which is quite poor. And lots of people died because of, you know, there was less infrastructure to protect the populations. So I really wanted to work on, you know, helping these people that were a bit more vulnerable. So again, United Nations, we always go back to this big organization because they really set the rules and they set like the vision for how we're going to change the world to help us adapt to this changing climate. And they said there's lots of options, but one of the options they looked at that I really liked is how about we try and enable people to stay in their homes? So if there's lots of people who are becoming refugees no one in the world wants to become a refugee, then one way to stop that is to help them to be able to stay in their homes. And with climate change, this is kind of known as adapting to climate change. So we kind of have an idea how the climate is changing. We know there's these more extreme weather events, the droughts are longer and the floods are more intense. So what is the way that we can help people to manage this? That was really the question that I started to look at. So one way is rainwater harvesting. Now, I spend my life talking about how good rainwater harvesting is because I think it's amazing. And what I love about it most is it's really, really, really simple. So rainwater harvesting is when you catch rain on your roof and it goes into a gutter or like a pipe, and then it goes down into a cistern. A cistern is just a fancy name for a tank that you store. And then you can use a pump to pump it to your house, and you can use it to flush the toilet, to have a shower. Even if you put chlorine in it, so that a little bit of chlorine so that you can drink it, then it becomes drinking water. And what's so good about rainwater harvesting is it's pretty cheap. You know, it's not expensive to do. And we've got rainwater pretty much everywhere. And rainwater is really pretty clean, surprisingly. You know, it's much cleaner than water you see on the surface of the ground. And in some countries that are very poor, people drink that surface water and then they get sick. So rainwater harvesting is a much better way to adapt to climate change. So this is what it looks like. And this is a picture of a tank in a country called Uganda, which is quite close to South Sudan. So it's in Africa again. But in Uganda, there's no war, so it's quite stable. And, you know, it's still quite poor, but people have a slightly better quality of life than in South Sudan. So this here, this is it in action. You've got this roof and then the pipe goes towards the tank and then you've got the water in the tank. So what's really good about this is what I mentioned before is if you've got a rainy season for quite a long time and then you've got a dry season, you want to make sure that in the rainy season there's not too much water so that's flooding your garden or flooding your house, and in the dry season you've got enough water to wash your dishes and have a shower. So when the rain falls on the house, some of it or quite a lot of it goes into the tank, so that prevents some of the rain from going into the grounds and the garden and flooding the garden. So that's really good. But then if you store it, if you store a lot of water and it's clean, which it is if you build the tank right, then families have water for the dry season. So then they don't have the drought, and then, they're more resilient to climate change. So for me, this is like a really, really, really good technique to look into and to talk to people about. So I mentioned this word resilience, which might be a bit complicated. But resilience basically means that people have the ability to be able to prepare for something that might be unpredicted, something unpredictable, something that's a bit new. And the thing about climate change is it's just creating these new weather patterns that are quite a shock to people and to the crops. And being resilient means that you can really be prepared for this kind of new weather pattern. So I sum this up in a term called water security. So being water secure means that you have enough water, just like we do here. We always have enough water. We don't even think about it. You've got it all year round. So you don't just have water in the rainy season. You've got water in the dry season, and that your water is a really good quality. And if you have these three things, then you're water secure. So the question of water security, places like the US, Canada, and the UK, it's not even a question because we'll always have this. Some parts of the US actually have a bit of drought, but mainly we've got this well. And in the poorer countries in Africa, they often don't have this. So really what I believe is through rainwater harvesting, we can help people work towards this. And then just a little bit of a last thing. So PhD research, it's funny because you should never ask anyone what their PhD is about, because they'll give you a really long wordy answer. But PhD research in general is about contributing to the world's knowledge about topics. And that's really, really important. But for me, I think what's really important is taking action on the research. You know, if you can take action to, take everything that you've learned and use it to help the world so that the world is equally a better place, then that's really important. So what I did is I put together a group and we built a charity called Blue Tap that does all of the things that I've spoken to you about here. So we really encourage populations in low-income countries and developing countries, populations that are a bit vulnerable, to make sure that their water's secure. And we fund rainwater harvesting projects, and we build some really cool technologies to clean the water. And that's a really fun part of, you know, applying the research to real world situations. So yeah, thank you for listening. All questions are welcome.
Outstanding. Thank you so much, Francesca. All right, guys, let's dive into questions as she gets out a screen share. We also got some groups watching on YouTube Live, so if you guys want to type in your questions there, I'll pass along as many as I can. But yeah, let's start with this New Olds class. If you guys have a question to kick us off.
I think we're okay, Jesse. I don't know if there's any grade 8 questions.
That's okay. We'll come back and we'll see if you guys have one in a minute. We'll go to Ms. Nagy's class then.
What'd you say?
No. No.
Questions?
Okay, we'll come back to you guys too. Oh, you have one. Okay. Come on up. And let me unmute you again. Good to go. Yeah, you're good.
What was your initial inspiration to help people with blue tap?
Okay, good question. So I was born in a really wealthy country. I had two parents that loved me. I got to go to school. I got to go to university. And I was just one of the really lucky people. I mean, I think we all are, because, you know, we're all in school. And I just felt that it was a really strong principle of mine that by being so lucky to be in this situation, I wanted to use that luck to help other people that just didn't have it. And one of the big things that decides whether you get to go to school is actually just the country that you're born in or the village that you're born in. So I really believe that everyone in the world should get to go to school and should get to drink clean drinking water. And I wanted to use my lucky situation to help other people that weren't, you know, weren't born into the same position.
Good for you. All right, let's go to Ms. Diesel's class. You guys have a question?
Yeah.
Yeah.
When you said the surface water is usually dirty, when that surface water evaporates, it's still dirty and it comes down as rain. So isn't the water still a little dirty?
Yeah, really good question. Really, really good question. So that's part of the water cycle. And sometimes when rain comes down, it can be dirty. So for example, in cities, it can get contaminated. But generally, water, because of the water cycle, because of the process, it's almost like a natural purification process. So rainwater hasn't been contaminated. So like the main way that water becomes contaminated is through interactions with humans and animals. And that's the biggest source of contaminants, actually. So rainwater, okay, yeah, it's been through the water cycle, but once it hits the roof, it hasn't really had any interaction with animals or humans. And so it tends to be quite good quality.
Yeah. So the act of evaporating it sort of removes some of those toxins and problems that are in the water?
Yeah, exactly. So it's like nature's own filtration process. That's what's so good about the water cycle.
Very cool. Thank you so much. All right, Ms. Presner's class, you guys have a question?
Hi, we have one question. Do you want to read it?
Okay.
Well, it's kind of two questions sort of in one.
Ooh, good. We like those.
How does the blue tap work and how is it made?
Okay, cool. Okay, so blue tap. So do you remember I said to you that three dimensions of water security are you want a lot of it, you want to have it all year round, and you want it to be good quality. So the quality thing is something that blue tap focuses on. And what we've built is we use 3D printing, which is the coolest technology, to build this really simple machine that puts chlorine in the water. So chlorine is a chemical, and in the water you have lots of pathogens, and pathogens are things like bacteria or viruses, and these pathogens can make you sick. And what the chlorine does is when it goes into the water, it kills like 99.9% of the pathogens. And that's really good because it then means that you can drink it. But you have to have just the right amount of chlorine in the water to drink it, because if you put too much in the water, then it tastes horrible. And if you don't put enough, then it doesn't kill all the pathogens. So the blue tap technology is a 3D printed venturi tube. Now, the science behind venturi tubes is, I think, a little bit higher. I think it's like, you know, when you're 18, 19, you learn it. But it's this cool system where water passes through a tube and it suddenly speeds up because the pipe is narrow. And as the water speeds up, the pressure drops and automatically the chlorine is put into the tube. So the machine that we've created is really cheap. It's like £10 or I guess like $15. And water flows through a pipe from the rainwater harvesting or in the house. And suddenly the chlorine's put in and it's just the right amount. And so you can drink it.
Very cool. All right, Ms. Sabella's class, you guys have one?
Okay. What is your plan to change climate change?
Oh, okay.
No pressure.
Fantastic question. Okay, this is very political. So when you talk about climate change, right, you have two elements of it. You have something called mitigation, which means stopping it happening. And you have something called adaptation, which is accepting that it's happening and trying to help people adapt to it. So I focus on the second thing, the adaptation. And I guess a big part of that is because it seems more practical. The mitigation is very difficult because there's so much politics involved. And I guess because of my mindset, I'm an engineer and I want to, you know, try and do something now to help it. And the mitigation, I guess we all know, is frustratingly slow. I think what kids are doing right now, so the younger generation, which is encouraging governments, you know, really telling governments, we're not going to stand for you releasing greenhouse gas emissions. I think that is the most powerful thing you can do, because kids saying that, the next generation, that's you guys, this is actually making governments change the laws. It's making people go, okay, let's invest in solar power, let's invest in wind power, rather than in coal and gas and other energies that release greenhouse gas emissions. So I guess in some ways, I focused on the adaptation because I try and avoid politics, but I think the mitigation is more important.
Understanding. That actually ties really nicely in with a question we got from a class online. So we've got a group, third grade from GEMS World Academy School in Chicago, and they want to know that they're learning to be researchers in third grade, and they want to know if you have any tips or advice to help them become better researchers, Francesca.
Okay. My best tip, research what you're interested in. So the best thing about research and about learning is there's going to be some things you're good at and some things you're not good at, but the things that you're interested in, it's so much easier to become really good at because you're always sitting down and learning and you want to be doing what you're doing. And I think the way that everyone can contribute to the world is by being really enthusiastic about what they study. So I would say that. And my second best advice is always double check things, because it's amazing when you think you've got something right and then you look again and you realize, oh, it looks different to the first time. So yeah, always double check things. And actually, when I was in like, I don't know the grades, it was year seven, so I think grade eight, my teacher set for me a question and it had 10 points in it. And, you know, the first 9 points, we had to do loads of things. And I spent like half an hour doing all of these things. And the 10th point said, don't do any of the things above, just sit with your pen on your desk. And she had set this question as a trick to show, like, you have to read through all of your questions first to really understand the problem. So my approach was always to like get in, do everything really, really fast. But what she was trying to teach me is, you know, slow down, assess the whole problem, and then you'll be able to answer the question better. So that always stuck in my mind as a clever trick she did.
Have you ever told the teacher how valuable that experience was?
I think at the time I was really angry because I spent half an hour doing all this work.
Okay, well, let us know if you do ever. We'll do a second to cover that. Ms. Virk's class, if you guys have a question.
Yeah, we do.
You do? Awesome.
What's the difference between the water in North America and South Sudan?
Okay, great. So, in general, not much. So The places where we get our water is mainly, the safest water is called groundwater. So do you remember I said it's the things that is underneath the earth, and that's groundwater, and it's stored in something called an aquifer, which is basically just a big area where the water is stored. This is the best type of water because it's really clean. So it's been protected because it's kind, there's rocks above it that protect it, and it's water that's filtered down. The next way that you get water is called surface water. So that's things like rivers that we see, and you know, you see through waterfalls, and that's also pretty good. And in the US, they get a lot of their water from surface water. But the issue with that is it's exposed. So it's exposed to the animals and to the humans. So there's more risk that it's going to be bad quality. South Sudan and the US both have groundwater and surface water. The reason that the US has, you know, everyone in their houses has water is because the US has is a higher economy. And so they've got better engineering infrastructure to get the water to people's homes. So that's the main difference, actually, is it's not about the original water. It's about how the human beings have built systems to get the water into people's homes.
Excellent. All right. I know classes are going to be leading fairly soon, so we're going to take three more questions. One from a group online to Miss Matz's class, grade 4-5 in Hawaii, want to know, how did they get the water in South Sudan before the well was dug or drilled?
I don't know. Honestly, that's a really good question. So actually what happened, what was interesting is this hospital that Doctors Without Borders built, it was in a really rural area. So rural is where, like, there's very few people. It's not in a city. And they built it. And when they built it, there was just 1,000 people living there. And then after 10 years, because this hospital had been built, 20,000 people came to live in the village. Because that's how much people appreciated being close to a hospital. So when the people came to the village, what they were doing is most likely they were doing rainwater harvesting, because it's really old, it's thousands of years old, but that probably didn't provide them with enough water. So then when the hospital came, they then asked for engineers, okay, can we get some better water? And what the engineers do is they can come and do a map, and so they can see under the ground where there's going to be water, and then they drill a borehole, and then they can pump it up. Yeah.
Cool. All right, Miss Hugg's class, if you guys have a question, the student who's like super excited, go for it.
What advice would you give young children who want to make a difference in the world?
Ooh. Okay, good question. My advice would be do what you love. My advice actually that I always give to everyone is get a skill. You know, the thing that's so good about engineering is you have a skill that's really needed. And actually you see after a lot of sort of natural disasters, so when there was tsunamis and cyclones, lots of people want to help. And wanting to help is a really fantastic thing. But in those situations, what you need is people with skills who can help get the communities back onto their feet. And the way that you can do this is you know, being a doctor, being an engineer, being a nurse, you know, being able to handle the money to pay the workers, you know, anything that's a skill, that is the best way for you to contribute to the world. And it doesn't have to just be science and technology and engineering. If your skill is talking to people, then that's also fantastic. You know, there's so many things that you can do with that. So do what you love and make what you love your career.
Outstanding. It's funny, I usually ask that question at the very end of the hangout, but we've covered it now, which is awesome. So we'll wrap up with a really nice one from Miss Payne's class. If you guys have one, come on up. If you don't, that's okay too, but hopefully you do. Hey.
Hi, I'll go mute.
Yep.
What are some solutions I have to help save climate change and make a big impact on the world?
Okay.
So,
all right. So you remember, my focus is on climate change adaptation, but I do have some opinions on the mitigation. And the mitigation is the word for reducing climate change, so stopping it happening. So my view is we need alternative technology. So things like solar power. You know, in my life, I've seen solar power change people's worlds because so there's lots of places in Africa where you just don't have electricity. And I've seen people with just one little solar panel, they can then power their phone or they can power their torch, and then they can start a small business so they can make money. And just solar power has changed so many people's lives. So the best way to stop climate change happening is for you guys to shout out to the world to say, we want people, we want our energy to come from renewable energy. So that's solar power and wind power. And hydropower, but solar and wind, I think, are the ones I'm most interested in. And I think if you guys shout out that, then we have a chance of, minimizing climate change.
Outstanding. Before we wrap up, because the question that I wanted to ask has been asked, because there's so many questions from students, especially online, we're getting a ton. Is there anywhere where kids can ask you more questions or find out more about what you guys are doing? Any websites we can point people to?
Yeah, so just Google Blue Tap. I can show you on my screen quickly.
I'll pass it along. I'll look up Blue Tap. I'll send it along to every single classroom, okay?
Yeah, Google Blue Tap and also my email or info at Blue Tap, the email there. Send us all your questions and we'll be able to answer them.
Outstanding. Francesca, that was amazing. Thank you so much for joining us. What we do at the end of every Hangout, and boys and girls, if you guys could get ready, I'm going to demute everyone's microphone. So if you guys could join me in saying a huge thank you to Francesca for joining us today. Everyone is water security. We love it so much. Thank you so much to all our classes. Francesca, thanks so much for joining us. We look forward to having you back soon, and congrats on such amazing work. Keep it up. It's amazing.
Thanks. All right. See you later.